Good morning, lovely listeners. My name is Cody.
And I'm Laz.
And we're not just across the pond. We're across the
other pond. The show where we go to Dollar Tree and buy way too many almost expired Butterfingers for $3, or three for a dollar.
That's a good deal.
I haven't been to Dollar Tree for a long time, but I remember that being one of the highlights is going there. And like, you know, when you go to, before you go to the movies, like you just like get like a purse that's way too big and then just fill it with a whole bunch of candy.
Yeah. Or a backpack, you know? Or your pockets or a hoodie.
You just go to Dollar Tree and you can get like 20 Butterfingers for like $5. You know, I just remember that was like the big, but it, you know, the thing is, it was like those Butterfingers that were like, you know how like when candy bars size? Get old, like the chocolate kind of turns white on the outside. It was always like that. But as long as you're in a dark movie theater, that didn't bother the taste, you know?
All right. So, today's episode, we have our first guest of season two, Andrew from the East Coast Games, Arid Jared developer.
Mm-hmm.
You want to say hi, Andrew?
Oh, hello. Sorry, I didn't know that was meant to talk. Hello. Hi. I am Andrew, otherwise known as East Coast Games on Instagram, Twitter. What's up?
Yeah, thanks That's for cool. coming on.
Yeah, thank
like,
you guys.
Yeah, I know it's
having me.
I know it's like really hard to, you know, schedule stuff with us being on two different parts of the world.
It's the same thing as like with friends and family. One of us is either going to be getting up super early or I'm going to bed super late. So nothing I'm not used to. It's cool. You guys are worth it. So yeah.
Thank you. That's nice to hear.
Yeah. So like, what we said, Andrew is developing a game all by himself. Like, so you're doing everything for Arid Jared, not getting help from anyone, right?
Yeah. You're making me sound so much cooler than I am, but yeah. A lot of this I'm looking up as I go with the process. So like, by no means am I a genius at any of this. I'm just taking my time real slow to like make everything look how I want and, you know, hopefully put out a project that I'm proud of as my first game. So
Dude, like along with this interview today, we also kind of want to just reminisce on some of the games that we know that are made by just one person.
Okay.
You know, like Undertale, there's Cave Story. Mm-hmm. There's also like the first Spelunky, I think is also a solo game development.
Papers, Please.
And sometimes it just blows me away that, you know, someone like Toby Fox or anything, like they do literally everything, like the pixel art, the music, the coding, the story writing, like all of those to me are very, very, very different areas.
Skill sets,
you know, and there's not a lot of crossover with a lot of them, right? Like, especially things like coding and story writing. Coding is so much more analytical and logical than like, you know, creative things like music and story writing. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, the first question I want to ask to you is first of all, what is your main background coming into the game and what skills did you have to supplement?
Supplement as in like, can you elaborate what you mean by that? Sorry.
So like, you know, you come in maybe as like, if I were doing it, I can't come in as a musician,
a
musician and a writer. But then there's some skills like coding that I would have to learn
through the process.
Along the way.
Funnily enough, I know Nintendo is just now putting out that game where it's like literally it's a game teaching you how to code to make your own games. I don't know if you guys saw that. I think it's like game.
I have
Game Builder Garage. I think I keep forgetting the name, but years ago, you guys know like the WarioWare games, right?
Oh yeah, I love WarioWare.
Do you know WarioWare DIY on the DS?
I know of it. Okay. I never played it though.
Okay, so that was like a super bare bones like intro. I don't even want to call it an introduction to programming. But it taught you the basis of like, in real coding, you use like if statements, but the game used like a switch and it was like, if switch is on, blah, 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 if switch is off, blah, blah, blah. And you literally would connect that to conditions. That I credit to like getting my brain used to if statements, because so much, like so often when I'm coding now, I actually think back to that game. It's really weird. But, I would say I have a little bit of background in music. So like making the melodies and stuff for the game with like beatbox and stuff. That's actually one of the easier parts. But the actual programming, if you could see my Google history with how many things, like even something as simple as like 8-directional movement, for some reason, like that was causing a lot of issues. And a lot of like the user interface stuff, that's like the not so fun stuff to code. A lot of that, lots of Googling involved there. So,
as someone who has a computer science degree, I'll tell you that is still probably as professional as some professional programmers.
Yeah. I hear that a lot, and that, I'm always relieved to hear that, especially from people with a computer science background, because then I feel like less inferior, I guess. And I've also always loved art, so transitioning into pixel art wasn't really like a huge difference from like something I would do on the paper. It just takes more time because you literally have to like click each dot, so and then animate them, which is like a whole nother thing. So sometimes you can get away with like the animations. Like I'll do this thing where I want to make it a monster like animated, but I don't want to like necessarily map out each individual frame. So I'll copy and paste like 10 frames of just like the default sprite I make, and then I'll like chip away at it, and then like through the 10 frames, I don't know how to explain this. Through the 10 frames, it'll get like all altered and look like it's like moving. Like, do you remember the animation style from like Ed, Edd n Eddy, where the lines were really weird? Kind of like that. Kind of like that, I guess. And then if you loop it looks a little more natural. Like, it's animated, but, like, it didn't require, like, your whole day. So, like, I'm kind of getting away with doing that, but I think, I don't know, I might have to clean up.
I think finding shortcuts like that is a major trait of developers in general.
Maybe.
Well, I mean, like, it's, I mean, that, and you're talking about, like, idle states for the sprites, right?
Yeah. Like, I mean, I also have, for each one, like, sprite literally underscore in pain, like when it's taking damage, and then versus the death animation, and if it's a boss, then there's like a recovery animation. One of the bosses is like a snowman, and you have to take out his snow gems to take away his force field, so he has like different animations for each phase. So he was one of the trickier ones to get working correct, which I still don't think he is, but yeah, I should say he is one of the ones that's more tricky to develop right now. So, yeah. But, yeah, you can kind of get away with, like, you know, by being experimental with animation, you can get away with, like, tricks and stuff like that. So, I would say that I definitely have to supplement animation skills, because I don't have them. I really don't have them. So,
Hey, practice makes perfect.
Yeah.
Or permanent.
Yeah.
So let's see, you got like, when I think of like developing a game, like those are like, I think of like those four areas. So like the art, pixel art, and I bunch animation with that. There's story. How do you feel about storytelling?
So I really feel like most people probably write out a story like in a notebook and then like execute it. I'm kind of just going with whatever I think is like funny. I write a lot of my own dialogue myself for like the characters. Like, I'll envision a character's like personality, and then based like what the reply to Jared, like based off of that. But as for the story, aside from like the main plot, like the main conflict. I haven't really like mapped out a lot in that department. I've been focusing more on like the gameplay. Mm-hmm. But I kind of like think about how like mm-hmm. Earthbound, like it has its story, but that game, it's all over the place. And that's kind of like mm-hmm. the beauty of it. So like, mm-hmm. if I could emulate that, mm-hmm. I don't know how well I'll be at doing that, but that would be like a cool thing to do, I think. Mm-hmm. So yeah,
it sounds like it's more of a character focus.
Yeah, definitely. I would like to make a more story focused game mm-hmm. in the future. But this one, given I'm like still kind mm-hmm. of like learning the ropes, it's kind of like gameplay first. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, like I guess so, that's another tenet of everything too, is the gameplay. The design in the gameplay, I would think, is also a big part of the development as well. Because, mm-hmm. like, it's... Because, like, in one sense, like, you got to think of, like, the play style, right? Mm-hmm. For instance, like, when you're looking at Undertale, like, Toby Fox came up with almost a completely new way of, you know, interacting with enemies in battle. Mm-hmm. You know, you have the little box with the heart and whatnot.
Right.
Even though it gets its roots from like the bullet hell games, mm-hmm. he's taking that and RPGs to a different level. Mm-hmm. You know, and like that kind of creative thinking within, you know, the gameplay design is also, I would think, is also something. I mean, it's kind of like in the in between of all these things we already talked about, right? You know, like coding and like pixel art design, all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, Cody, did you have something you wanted to?
I was going to start the next question.
Oh, okay. Well, we can do that.
So that kind of goes off the other question, but how long have you had Arid Jared in the works? And when was like your first inkling of starting it?
He started in February. No, yeah, it was February of 2020. Okay. Yeah, it was February 2020. I started game development a little bit before that, though, in the October before that. So in Japan, a lot of like little towns here have their own mascot characters. And mine is like a little.
Yeah, like everywhere.
Yeah, yeah. Mine in the town I live in is like this little chibi princess based on an actual princess who like lived here years and years and years ago. And so I made like a Super Mario Brothers ripoff based on an engine I created from a YouTube tutorial, but I like inserted her into it. And like everybody here was so like thrilled to see that. Like they were like, oh my God, it's like Mario, but it's like Mehime. Like it's like our town. And like the background was like real locations from the town, like the temple we have, the museum we have. And from there, I was like, oh, this is cool, but like I want to make a game that I want to make, like not based on anything that already exists. And yeah, I've just always really loved cacti. I wish there was a deeper meaning to it than that, but it really is just, I think they're cute and I thought it would make a cute character. So they're also easy to draw. So that works in my favor with like creating assets and stuff. So yeah. But that's actually the most time-consuming part, because like I can say, yeah, I've been developing this game since February of 2020. But if you look at somehow you could like look at a pie chart of where all my time has went in that process, a giant chunk of it would be just creating assets, and then like maybe I want to say like 25% of that time has been actual coding, which it doesn't look like that if you look at like my Instagram, but yeah. If I ever like grow, that's one of the big things I want to like hire someone else to do for me so that I can just focus on the programming part. So
that's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So assets are the most complicated, I guess, when it comes to, because I guess the programmer you get to use over and over almost, because once the game design's done, then you're just working on assets for all the different locations.
That, but I'm also striving to make, it's not going to be a very long game, but I'm trying to make each level that is there unique and feel like its own little like vignette. in a sense. So each level has its own wave of unique enemies that have different attack patterns. And then each stage has a boss. And then there's three main bosses at the end of each, like, they're not worlds, but like each row of stages on the world map. And from each boss, Jared can actually earn a new spell to use in combat that you can like...
Oh, very Mega Man-like.
Right. So while it's not going to be like a super long game, that's one thing that like, if I was just going to make like a basic engine and be able to copy and paste it between like levels, that would be one thing. But because each stage has its own sort of like mechanics and like boss patterns, there is probably a lot more coding involved than like, I guess like other games that kind of follow that pattern. So each level of the game, I'm striving to make them very unique and different from each other. So like, not that I'm about to sit here and criticize Mario Brothers. I just will never do that. But it's kind of like stage like 1-1, 1-2, 1-3. You can clearly see how like each one is like a progression of the last in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
So like I'm trying to take that, but make each stage feel like its own thing entirely, if that makes sense, based on like setting, the enemies there. Each stage has its own boss. So because of that, each boss requires its own unique like programming to make it work the way that I want it to. And because of that, like I do still debate, like I could extend the game's length, but it would almost feel artificial to just copy and paste, like say I took stage one and then copy and pasted that like four times and slightly varied the gameplay of each, or like laid out like the layout of obstacles differently. I could do that, but it feels like almost, I like games that like respect the player's time, and like, I kind of like, even if it's a short game, I want each level to feel like it matters and that it was like placed there with intention, if that makes sense.
That's really cool.
Not just filler, because like depending on the game, I do like filler, but like if it's something like Breath of the Wild, I'm the type that wants to find like every Korok seed. But like if it's something like if it's something like this, I feel like in my game's case, I don't think it would work in its favor, if that makes sense.
Right, because it's not like exploration based; it's like gameplay.
No. It's like each stage is actually pretty small, but the layout of each one changes, like the settings, the like style, the boss, the enemies. And I'm experimenting now with like, up until a certain point, the player is used to like just straight up attacking each enemy directly with the spells. But I'm trying to do this system for like one of the later levels where you have to cast your spell onto like this like pillar thing. And then from that, you gain control of that. And you have like a split second to choose the direction that that fires something at. And you have to hit the enemies way. So like while you dodge, you have to be thinking about like, because when this is like a lot to explain at once, but when Jared casts his spell, the mechanic of the gameplay is that you can attack and you have total freedom over like where the attack goes, but Jared becomes sedentary because he buries himself in the sand. So you have to strategize where you want to do that, because wherever you do that, you're going to be vulnerable. Until he casts the spell and can like revive himself. So I'm trying to take that.
That's really cool.
Thank you. I'm trying to take that and like think about, well, how would that naturally progress in difficulty and not artificially? So that's why I'm thinking of things like that pillar thing I just explained, and like different ways to use that. There's another one I'm planning right now where it's like, when you cast the spell, you get a little cursor that you take control of. But now I'm playing with something where there's these things shooting across the screen, like these like smokes of like these like clouds of smoke. And if the cursor hits that, you lose the cursor and it goes invisible. So like now you just don't even know. So like the strategy is like, have that while still aiming. But like this is all like still like experimental talk right now. In actual gameplay, I don't know how well it will work until I actually like try it. So yeah, these are just ideas.
I love your thought process of unique difficulty stuff, because a lot of games find difficulty in just giving the enemies more health.
Yeah.
Or putting a original enemy back later in the game that's just like a different color and is harder. I love the unique style of, you have to learn a mechanic and now apply it in a completely different way. I think that gives a lot more replayability and just fun in general than just I have to hit this more.
right. Which I can appreciate just a good scaling system of like enemies just straight up becoming stronger, like more HP. But I think in Era Jared, it doesn't really fit the gameplay that well. Like to use Breath of the Wild again, I think it fits that gameplay well because you feel stronger as you're like growing. But Jared, aside from like, there is an upgrade system that you can spend experience on, but it doesn't change the strength of the attack. It you can increase the speed in which he casts the spell. You can increase his like run speed, but you can't actually upgrade the strength of the spell. So like you're getting stronger, but it's in ways that like aid how it aids you if you're already good at the game, if that makes sense.
Really rewarding just getting good at the base mechanics.
Like you still have to be good. It's not like, I don't just want to hand you like, oh, now this will do double damage. Like, no, you can cast the rune faster, but you still have to cast it, if that makes sense.
So yeah, like, I getcha.
Yeah.
That's a very Metroidvania kind of approach to it.
That's That is a great compliment. Thank you.
Yeah, because like that's what I've noticed. That's what I've noticed with games like Hollow Knight. It's like you have to be good throughout the entire game. God.
That game. That is on my rage quit list right now. I have to go back to that someday. But that game, he's so cute. And like you don't expect it to be as hard as it is. Like going into it. Like I was like, oh, he's a cute character. Like I hear people talk about this game. Let me try it. And then I think it was Hornet, the character getting like their own game now. I just couldn't do it. Yep. I couldn't do it. I was like, I can't do this. Like she's just whipping across the screen and like, it's not a game that gives you a checkpoint right before the boss too. So like you have to like track all the way back and I'm like, no, I can't do it.
There's a checkpoint by Hornet. You just gotta find it. Yeah. There's one below there.
I'm not very thorough with Metroid.
You gotta Cody is speed runs that game, so he knows every nook and cranny of it.
Yeah, yeah. I did for probably 6 months or so. I attempted speed running it.
Yeah, and he told me that he used to do it all on the Chinese translation because Chinese doesn't take up too much.
It loads faster.
Yeah,
it loads faster.
You can get through the text faster.
I've heard of people using different versions, like cultural versions, to speed run. Before
they used to do, this is completely tangential, but Kingdom Hearts 2 used to do the Japanese version is faster because of the text.
Yeah,
but when they created the 2.5 remix for PS4, Donald Duck's duck flare move got a huge damage boost. So even though you can save a ton of time with text and talking in the Japanese translation, it's way faster in the later game once you have duck flare to just have the damage boost from the English version, so they play it in English now.
I can't.
Wow.
Like, I don't know how they map that out. Yeah. It's insane.
No, sorry, go ahead.
You know, I used to think that speedrunning and stuff like that was just a waste of time. But like after hearing Cody talk about all that stuff and then like watching some videos on like how to get things frame perfect and whatnot, like once I start hearing all the lingo and how they really like started, because like you also have to have like an intense love for a game if you're going to speed run it, you know?
Yeah,
because you got to be able to be, you know, be practicing that game like every day and like going over the same scene over and over and over and over again. So like that really got a completely different perspective on speedrunning for me, you know?
And you know who's a speedrunner when, like, a remake of a game gets announced and, like, sometimes speedrunners are, like, not happy about it because, like, they can already tell from the trailer, like, oh, I can't get away with, like, what I was doing up to this point anymore.
Yeah, you can tell they fixed the bug fixes.
Yeah. I used to watch a lot of the SpongeBob Battle for Bikini Bottom speedruns because, like, those were super crazy, and I was addicted to that game in, like, first grade. And it was just crazy to see the stuff that people were pulling off. But then when they made a remake, which was so random, by the way, that they made...
Yeah, it's an insane thing to remake.
Yeah, that was... People hate that remake, especially speedrunners. And it's because they can't get away with, like, these game-breaking glitches anymore. So, I don't know. It's just funny to see that. So...
You know, like I was just thinking about the thing you were talking about earlier about really respecting the gamer's time.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me think of another Zelda game that I've heard people, and I think Aaron Ego Raptor, you know, like he had did a sequelitis about this. I think it's him, but there he was talking about how he hated Ocarina of Time because a lot of the enemies just made you wait and it gave the illusion of being hard. You know, like for instance, like the main thing was like the spiders, like to be able to defeat them, you just stood there and waited for it to I don't know, get angry and shake a little, and then it turned around like a bratty child, you know.
Yeah.
And then you like hit its back and then you defeat it. Like there's a lot of enemies in Ocarina of Time that are like that. And I think in one respect that was like what you were saying, it was kind of like almost disrespecting the player's time.
Yeah. It's kind of just like I believe in quality over quantity. And so like I want to keep, my goal is to keep the player's interest from start to finish. Even if it takes an hour to beat the game, I want that hour I want the player to leave the game feeling like that hour mattered versus there was a lot of like fluff. There was a lot of filler. I really don't think all filler is necessarily bad. I think there are a lot of games that I can actually appreciate it. And I love, if you love a game already, then it's easy to love just more to do. But again, in my game's case, I just think, I don't want any new mechanic introduced in like a level to overstay its welcome. Like once, if I feel like I can realize it, I want to just move on and like never make the player super comfortable with something they come across. I want the next level to just throw that all away and you have to learn something completely new to beat the boss. Mm-hmm. So
I like it.
Thank you. That's cool. I'm talking about it like so confidently. We'll see how it comes out in execution. But
you know, that's like a completely different thing. It's the same in the music realm. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yep.
Yeah.
But as long as you have a solid idea, that's always something to work off of. And I think this sounds like a really solid idea.
Yeah. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah. And as for filler, we know the only fillers that matter are going to the beach, the spa. Right?
Gotta have the hot tub episode.
Yeah.
The hot tub episode.
Episode.
Well, I'm trying to think of like, I love collectibles in games too.
No, I love collectibles.
It would be cool to have like a hidden collectible of each level and you had to like, ooh, I don't know, cast a spell in just the right spot to find it. But like, I don't know, that's a very like raw idea. I think it needs more developing. So, because then you would get players that just happen to like bomb that spot and find it, and like I want to see, like, you have to actually intend to find it. I need to find a way to like, you know, make it that way. But we'll see. Mm-hmm. We'll see.
Oh yeah, like me and Cody were talking about collectibles in, I think in the Metroidvania episode. Like I was talking to him how like one of my favorite collectibles of all time, was from Banjo-Kazooie, like the question mark eggs and the crystal key. I don't know if you ever played Banjo-Kazooie and Banjo-Kazooie.
I have not, but I have seen some gameplay on YouTube, like the golden puzzle pieces and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's pretty much what is it, Mario 64 kind of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, like each level has like a whole bunch of different puzzle pieces and whatnot. And then a lot of little other different collectibles. Mm-hmm. But the mystery eggs were an interesting attempt at like linking the games together. Like originally what they wanted to do was that you could get all the eggs after you're done with everything in the original game. And then you did something to get that data over to the second game. And then you were able to get the crystal key. And then that was supposed to go on to the next game. And it, at that time, it was really hard to get like that kind of technology to work.
Mm-hmm.
But because it didn't work, it actually intrigued people like me even more that it's almost like this thing that you're not supposed to access. You know what I'm saying?
Wait, so
like, it was like
the save files would know if a different game save file had a certain thing.
Well, the thing is, like, they didn't know how to get it to work. They just kind of decided, okay, we're going to, we'll figure it out later, but right now we'll put this code in and we'll have like these in the game, but like we'll figure out a way that they can kind of cross between the games later on to get
like
them.
Sequel to but, sequel kind of thing.
Well, like I think what the idea was, like you put it in the original game and they can't, with like the stuff that they have in the game right now, mm-hmm. like they, at that time I should say, like you can't get the eggs. You're not supposed to get the eggs. What you're supposed to do is like go to Banjo-Tooie and then do something there and then be able to get that, finish something there and then go back to the other game and get the eggs and then be able to go back to the other game and get the crystal key. So it was like
an interactivity between both game save files would know to unlock
somehow this. They didn't know. Yeah.
So that's, what's the word I'm thinking for? Very progressive for N64 times. Because I think Banjo-Kazooie came out just after they came out with the expansion pack for the N64.
Yeah, I think that's what
Donkey
they were...
Kong required that.
Yeah,
came
I think
with the
that's
game.
What they were trying to do. But at the same time, like it, I think what happened is like later on, they, because you know how like game developers will usually have, like when they're testing things out, they'll usually have like some sort of override within the game to get to certain places, mm-hmm. you know? Like they left, because there's like this part in Treasure Trove Cove, like the beach level, where there's like this cave and then there's these letters on the floor and you hammer dropped them to put in a password and it did something in the game. And there was a password that when you put it in, it didn't register. Like usually it like blinks or something to tell you, oh, you got it right and whatnot. But then for this one to get the egg in there, it just didn't do anything. It was just like the developer was supposed to know, okay, you put this in and then you go over there, you can get it. So like later on, people figured that out somehow, you know, and then they start being able to get the egg. And it's like really weird because like in all the other collectibles in the game, you get it and it makes like a sound. It's like, oh, you got it. Wow. Hooray. But this, it just like silent. It was almost eerie. You know?
Yeah, that's weird. I think
but that you know that
is like an mm-hmm. underdeveloped idea, like interconnectivity between games. Because like mm-hmm. you talking about this reminded me that like in Metroid Prime 3, your Wii mm-hmm. would know if you had a save file for, I think it was the Paper Mario game. And then on mm-hmm. Samus's ship, there would be a sticker of Paper Mario. So like they figured it out, but that's like as far as at least Nintendo ever took it in Wii era. And it's interesting that, like, more developers don't do anything with that mechanic. I guess because, like, it's a lot... You don't want a lot of content between, like, two games because from a marketing standpoint, like, you're asking people to buy two games, in a sense. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the DLC argument people have. Like, you're going to make me pay to, like, for a game that's not finished or, you know, something like mm-hmm. that. But mm-hmm. that's a very interesting mechanic, I think. Like... linking
I think the only games
together in that way
well, that like, I've heard do stuff like that are like big RPGs like the Mass Effect mm-hmm. series, the Witcher series mm-hmm. both have that where you can transfer saves between mm-hmm. but the idea that you can go from the second game back to the first one, that's such a unique idea that I can't yeah. believe they thought of that in the Nintendo 64 era.
Yeah,
well, you know, the thing that that I'm more interested in, to be honest though, is not the interconnectivity between games, but the idea like why as a kid that those eggs were so much more like collectible in a sense than anything else in the game. Like I didn't care about getting all the golden jigsaw pieces and whatnot. Like when I heard that this, it was like a secret in the game, and then you figure it out, like you go to those places and it doesn't register the same way other collectibles do, it increased its value in my head, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And like it seems that way, like when you get use like a game shark to get stuff like in a game and then you like show it off to your friends, it feels like so much cooler because it's like you're able to, it's almost, it makes you special in a way to be able to go to get something that other people don't know how to get, you know? And yeah. almost that you're not supposed to get. Like the first time, like someone showed me missing no in like the original Pokemon games, I lost my shit. I was like, oh my God, like you can do this, you know? And like seeing like someone with like 150 level 150 Zapdos and whatnot, or like a Charizard with water gun, you know, it was like that. That's the thing that the collectibles in like the Easter eggs, like the literal like mystery eggs in the original Banjo-Kazooie kind of had on me.
Yeah.
Like the interconnectivity with games was a cool thing, but I like that the artifact left over from that attempt actually became almost a...
like the little Easter eggs.
Well, it literal Easter eggs, and it increased the value because it wasn't supposed to be accessed by the gamer, you know?
That's interesting to think about, too, because, like, depending on the developer, like, some developers, like, really police that stuff to the point where, like, they do not want you to have any fun with this game outside of, like, how we wanted you to have fun with it versus, like, developers who embrace it and will go as far to, like, make it a mechanic in the next game. Like, I know you might know this, Cody, as a speedrunner, but the original Metroid Prime has, like, you can access the space jump boots before you're supposed to by jumping very strategically. Like, I don't know how people calculate the frames and all that, but you have to jump off Samus's ship to land on this ledge in a super weird, specific way. But Retro took that out during the Wii remakes, and speedrunners were, like, really upset about it. Like, we get, like, that's not intended, but like a casual player would never accidentally do this. Like,
yeah.
So why are you taking it out for the people who want to, like, I don't know, have fun with it, or like speedrun, like just for fun, or like something like Animal Crossing. It's funny to see, like, now New Horizons, because I remember, like, during like the Wii and DS, people with action replays were doing all the stuff that you see in New Horizons now, but like illegally, in a sense, because it was like people would get seeds to put furniture outside, or like really malicious people would like put buildings in front of really important stuff so that you couldn't access it anymore. Like when they visit your town, they would drop like a police station seed, and then now you can't enter your house because you saved and like overwrote the file that way. So like I get policing it in that sense, but I think like if it's just like a harmless exploit, like I don't see the point in like removing it if it's just something for fun. So. Yeah,
I agree. Because, like, it makes... I mean, it just... Like I, with the thing I said before, it just makes it so much special, more special to you, because then it's like, ooh, I know something other people don't.
Yeah, that, you know, only
like,
the devs
kind
know.
Of like being able to go to, like, World Negative One in Super Mario Bros.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Or it's kind of like...
really cool one.
It's the same principle as, like, if mom tells you no, what's like, well, now you want to do it more. So, like, you may as well embrace it. So.
Yeah. And I think a lot of people, when they, like, put things on, like, the Wii Marketplace and stuff for people, they want to revisit. They want that that burst of nostalgia again. And, like, one of those things, like really, for me, is those little secrets.
Yeah.
Especially as a kid, those meant so much.
Yeah.
You know?
Uh-huh. I don't know that I had any experiences like that with any games growing up where I was like, this is bad, I shouldn't be able to access this in the game, but here I am. I definitely heard of people like breaking stuff, but like I myself didn't. I knew people that had homebrew on Wii.
I did.
Yeah. You seem like the type.
Like, well, I mean,
kid,
like
that kid in school.
Oh, do I? No. Am I like a criminal or something?
No, but like, I don't know. I could see being that cool with like the homebrewed Wii.
Well, like to be honest, like the only thing I use the homebrew Wii is for like watching Netflix on my Wii, and what was the other thing? Oh, like putting just getting MP4s and being able to watch them on my Wii. Like I didn't really do anything else with it, or did I? I think I tried.
I'm not judging. I think it's funny, but.
My first exposure to that was I actually had a cousin who had a an Xbox that they'd modded that had every game that you could get on the Xbox.
Oh, yeah.
Because there was a game, I think it's my friend has talked to me about this multiple times. I think it's a Mech Warrior game. Was it had a load buffer that you could access and basically just wipe the Xbox OS, put on your own stuff, and then just download the ROMs for every single game that existed.
Oh my God.
Microsoft refuses to remake that game and put it up for like the Xbox One series because they have a ton of backwards compatibility now. They refuse to let that game have access just in case somebody could still break it.
And oh, wow. Like break it as in like glitch the game.
Yeah, so you would basically break that game so that you could break into the whole Xbox.
Ah, got you.
Oh wow, that I just think it's like Murphy's Law. Like if something like anything that can happen will happen, kind of thing. Like yep. It's like if you don't tell anybody about like one little like access point in a game, then they're gonna find it whether you tell them or not, you know.
Yeah,
it's crazy that can happen.
Or it's usually like stuff where it's like, why is this not a feature to begin with? Like I follow a lot of these Animal Crossing pages, and there's all these hot tub items in the game that you just can't get in, like officially. Uh-huh. You can't get in the hot tub in the game. So people found this glitch to like, if you wedge it into a corner in your island and then you like use the ladder item at this weird angle, you can climb up the ledge and your character will get into the hot tub and then you can sit down. And it's like people go to these lengths, we just want to take a picture in the hot tub. Like, why is this not? Like, I don't know, it's just funny. If people go full FBI to do stuff like this. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Never underestimate the power of a group of gamers.
No, don't.
I also think Nintendo probably like goes to lengths to make everything family friendly. Like even things that are slightly somewhat kind of suggestive, like a jacuzzi, like mm-hmm. They'll be like, "Nah, we don't want that in our game."
Yeah, but they kind of throw that out the window when they give us a little like design editor. Because people just go,
oh yeah,
jam on that with like whatever they want, mm-hmm. like because I think that's why they're so rigid about like you need friend codes, and sometimes even if you have a friend code, you need that friend's original code for this game just to access their content because they don't want like malicious people to like infest the network, mm-hmm. I guess, which I can understand. Like I was talking about WarioWare DIY. That literally gave people the power to like make their own games and assets. And like, there was some really dirty stuff circulating on that game, on like and stuff. And it's like, yeah, it's like what you said, anything that can happen will, like people just,
yeah,
this is why we can't have nice things.
Yeah. I mean, like I've seen the same thing with the level editor in Super Smash Bros. Like I think there, I saw like a level where it was like Mario like in like a speedo or something like that, like like the whole level was just that.
I would pay so much money to watch like a Sakurai reacts to what people have done with like Smash in general, like not just the level editor but like mods and stuff.
He's so rigid in what he wants the game to be. It's so funny. Or this is not how you play the game.
It'll be like Smash Bros mod Squidward versus Shrek. And it'll be like King DDDS Shrek and Squidward is like, I don't even know. And it's like, all they did was swap out like the main, like, not CGI, computer generated like
character
model.
Asset. Yeah.
But like the boxes are the same. So the character gets like all screwed up when they're like doing like the attack of the Marth. But it's like your Squidward. But like, yeah, it doesn't work.
That sounds amazing. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that.
Yeah, I would love to see him react to that. If people do that stuff with Air Jared, I'm all for it. I would sit with popcorn and just watch it all night.
Oh yeah, I'm sure like that's like one of the things like a lot of developers and like musicians like myself too, like also kind of look forward to one day is like starting to get like fan remakes of things. Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that means like people are watching and people are following and people are interacting with the stuff that you make, you know?
Yeah. Because I wouldn't even be like mad. Like, oh, you're screwing with my like body of work, but it's like, A, it's hilarious, and B, mm-hmm. like, it means you have fans, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, people are taking your thing and like making something with it. So
I'm going to make a note here that I'm going to speed run Arid Jared. I'm going to be the first one on leaderboards.
Please. Maybe I'll purposely put in some like game breaking stuff for you to like find.
Dude, that would be a good like part of like the marketing campaign is like sitting down and like going through it like like as fast as possible. That would be cool too.
It's I sometimes like it's weird when I'm programming. I actually do think like I have the thought like how would like a speedrunner think about this, like, and I'm not making the game based on like a speedrunner's mindset, but like it is interesting to think about. I think it was a quote from Miyamoto, actually. I would have to find who said this, but it was basically like a good puzzle has multiple solutions, or a good objective has multiple solutions. So like if the goal is to get from A to B, give the player more than one option to get there. And so like my interpretation of that for Arid Jared is creating different spells to use, because they all function essentially the same. Like I said, there's no way to increase the strength. Like one hit is one hit no matter what spell you use. But because of that, I'm changing like the properties, so you have different options of like what spell to assign to him. And then you can only take one spell into a level at a time. So that's like what you're stuck with, and unless you go and change it.
Okay.
So like the main one, it's just a giant circle as the cursor that detonates when you hit the space bar. And anything in that hitbox takes damage or dies. But then the next rune you can unlock is similar, but instead of being the giant rune, it's a smaller one. But when you detonate it, it shoots out in like a triangular direction, like three smaller ones. So like it's smaller, but it shoots out. So there's like a little more dexterity with it. So like depending on what kind of player you are, like you can line up and literally kill three things in one shot if you line it up correctly. So like people who feel good with that choose that one, whereas people who just want the safe option, me, is stick to like one. So I'm still thinking of like different patterns, and I'm not sure like how many different spells will be in the game, but yeah, it's fun to just play around with that. But you gotta have them like balanced. You can't have one just be like the clear winner.
Oh yeah, you can't have like, what is it, the Deus Machina kind of thing? Like, because like, what is it? It's like part of game theory that like whatever overpowered weapon is in the game, it's going to be the one that's going to be used all the time. So, like, and actually, I've been thinking about that recently, just like playing RuneScape is like, oh, there's a lot of these guides now that have like different ways to get from 1 to 99. And usually there's the fastest way, then there's alternative ways, but then there's the ways to profit while you're going. And so like it gives you choices, you know, like also depending on your own conditions at that time too. And I like that quote you gave, like it gives the player room to be themselves a little more, you know?
Yeah. I think that like, that's a really good philosophy. And when I really thought about it, like, yeah, like I guess my favorite games do give me more control. Like that's just a factor that makes a game better in my opinion. Obviously that's like up to the player, but, that's why I do enjoy something like Breath of the Wild more than like, or, you know, I'll use Mario as an example, like why I enjoy Mario Odyssey versus 3D World, because one is literally just A to B. And one is A to B, but you can go in any order you want. You can clear any objective in pretty much any way you want, because it's like an open sandbox. So I'm the kind of person who prefers that. But I also get that like that varies from person to person. So yeah, it's a good way to just cater to like all kinds of players. I think RuneScape is really good at that, because like some skills are combat based where it's like in real time, you got to be like focused and like whatever, but then some are literally just withdraw from bank, click inventory, put back in bank,
repeat. Yeah.
So like, which and you can like, I think it's too while doing it. So like that keeps you in the world as well. So
yeah. See, and that's the other thing. There's also AFK ways to do stuff too. Yeah. So like it also caters to what your conditions at the time are too. Like for instance, like now when I watch YouTube videos, I like to just like woodcut because it kind of, it's almost like a fidget toy to me. It's like you're, you know, you feel like you need to do something with your hands, but you don't know what to do. So might as well just click endlessly on maple trees or something.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So like, but you know what? Like I was wanting to try to steer this conversation back to solo game development. So like, I'm just like wondering now, like, what kind of games that are like done by just one developer that you really admire?
I haven't played as much as I would like to. I mean, the obvious answer would be Undertale. I know we've already said that, but like you said, I think that the way that that game broke conventions for RPGs and created a battle system that was like a hybrid of different genres, like Bullet Hell, or even like, you know, like those games that, I guess they were more popular back then, but like text-based games where like choosing options. It's so cool that he like incorporated, if you're doing like a pacifist run of Undertale, to kind of figure it out as like a puzzle. Like, how can I spare this creature? Because it's rarely like obvious in that game.
Oh my God, yeah.
I didn't even know that you could spare them. Like, I thought that was just like an option, like flee. So I totally went through like massacring everything in my path. And then at the end of the game, when I realized I never had to kill anything, like even like that like motherly lady figure in the beginning.
Yeah, Toriel.
Yeah. I was like, what? I didn't have to kill her. She was so nice. So what? And then I felt horrible. And like that to me stood out. And like the fact that I like remember that ending and that emotion with it to me made it a good game. If for anything else, just the feeling I left from playing it, the fact that it stayed with me. So yeah, that would be like the dream, to achieve an effect like that. Aside from that, I'm sure I've played other solo developed games, but I just don't know that they were solo developed. Spelunky I downloaded, but then my computer like wouldn't run it because I'm on a Mac. But I would love to play that. I've watched a lot of people on YouTube play that. Is that like auto generated?
Like, it is procedurally generated. Yeah. Every run is different. It's a roguelike.
Yeah.
Isn't it kind of like 20XX?
Yeah, it's like all those, like
20XX. That's awesome. Also kind of does that.
That's, I really want to play that.
It's the most brutal game I think I've ever played.
It's hard.
I think Spelunky and Spelunky 2 might be the hardest, most unforgiving games I've ever played.
Really?
Yeah.
It just is like, you can be doing really well and then instant death literally everywhere. There's not a single level that doesn't have an instant kill option.
Yeah.
That like, actually sounds like something I would like though. Cause like,
oh yeah, it's invigorating.
I mean, like I think it kind of harbors back to like the original, like hard, like difficulty of games. Like back in the Super Nintendo era, there was a lot of games that were just unforgiving, you know?
Like, you just run out of lives and have to play the game again. Like, not the level, the game.
Yeah.
And I mean, like, the times that I've played Spelunky have been with Cody and my brother, and both of them are some of the best gamers I know, and it's like, they're dying just as much as I am. I'm like, well, that probably is, Spelunky's probably a pretty hard game then, you know?
But that sounds like, again, I keep going back to Breath of the Wild. I just started Master Mode, and that's, like, why I think I'm bringing it up.
Oh my god, Master Mode's brutal.
Yeah, but like something about that game, in the beginning, you're so weak and everything kills you and you're like, oh my God, I'm dying, but this is awesome. And like, I don't want to stop. But then as you get like stronger, everything is so much less of a threat that I almost wish the game stayed that difficult the entire time. And like, I know you can like purposely not get like the hard containers and stuff to like artificially make it more difficult, but like, I want a game that literally just stays in that difficulty bubble or even gets harder until you finish. And like Spelunky seems like that. Like,
I would put Spelunky in that category for sure.
You're never like safe. Yeah.
Yeah.
That seems refreshing to me.
The problem nowadays is that all these big companies are trying to cater to also these more casual gamers as well. So like there's you got to kind of target people. like from the beginning. And that actually will probably, well, I mean, it will like change the way you develop a game too. Like, for instance, like people like my mom that just like to sit there after work, like watching Ghost Hunters and just like click things like on her iPad to play like Candy Crush. Yeah. You know, that's like catering to exactly what she's doing. Just like come home from work, don't want to think. Just, it's kind of like that game that you see on what is the guy on Rick and Morty, the Jerry plays at the table, is just like balloons, and then he's just like clicks at it and it pops the balloons, and it doesn't do anything else but that. Like there's like that level, like Jerry from Rick and Morty level gamer, and then there's like speedrunners that try to master every nook and cranny of a game.
Yeah.
And it's like, then you got to think as a developer, okay, what difficulty do I want? Do I want Jerry, or do I want, you know, I can't even think of like a famous speedrunner, but you know, like, just like, it's, I'm sure that like, just trying to figure out the difficulty of the game in the beginning is a big part of every, of like structuring the game in general.
Yeah.
So do you only have a single difficulty for Era Jared? Like, are you just going to leave it as just one difficulty the whole game?
As of right now, that has been the plan, to just have it as one fixed mode. Yeah, still not that far in development to think about like difficulty settings, but it's I mean, I haven't never thought of it, but like just the thoughts of like, when you think about difficulty, there's like such a way to do it where it's where it's not artificial versus when it is. And like, there's the whole philosophy that a lot of people are against, where it's like, oh, just plop more enemies in, now it's harder. It's like, well, yeah, it is, but like, not, it's not like a satisfying difficulty that way. So like, if I did that, I would want it to be like, I don't know, what I would want to do is actually go the extra step and literally program a new attack pattern for bosses, like each boss in a practical that'd be really world, cool. In a practical world, don't know if I would do that. Because just the effort that it's taking just to get through the main game, and I don't want to, I don't want to never put the game out. So like, that's what I would want to do, like what I would aspire to do. But yeah, we'll see. We'll see what happens with that.
There's an interesting philosophy in a developer's difficulty being the only difficulty, because like Dark Souls, I think, is the game that has like that.
I was just thinking about that
as its basis. Is it's going to be a hard game? I'm only making like. Fuck, what's his name? It's Miyamoto, I think, is who does the Dark Souls stuff. But it's just, this is the only difficulty of the game. You have to beat it on the way that I designed it. And but some I people like
such a
break it
thing that's like almost dying in gaming, because like, I know that like Nintendo is very a lot of their target demographic is a younger audience, and they want their stuff to be more accessible, which I can understand. But then I just think back to like something I'll probably never get over, and like I'm not gonna get on like a soapbox on your podcast, but like Paper Mario, don't even get me started. It's such a sore subject, and it makes me so sad, because I don't know if you guys have played the earlier games in the series, but they were like a lot closer to like a true RPG. And then now the games are kind of just like slapstick humor about being paper. I mean, I'll be fair. Like, I've heard the newer ones are like getting better. Like, I've heard very good things about the more recent one. But
I said, my wife played through Origami King, and it looks cool. Yeah, I never played the original Paper Mario or Thousand Year Door.
But I have to agree with Andrew. Like, when I played Super Paper Mario. Like, I actually bought it because I just assumed it was going to be a revamp or like at least the same mechanics as the originals, you know, because that's what I loved about the originals, especially in one that I don't see in RPGs anymore that I really, really, really miss is being able to click at a certain time to get a boost.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't know why they don't do that anymore. You know, like I loved it all the way back in Super Mario RPG. That was like, I think that was probably the original RPG to do that mechanic.
Yeah.
And then it was Paper Mario, Thousand Year Door, And then you also have, like, I think Mario and Luigi did that as well. Yeah. You know? Actually, and that was, yeah, like, but then Super Paper Mario changed the game completely. And it's like,
yeah,
it turned it into a platformer, you know?
Super Paper Mario was a super unique thing because it was actually being developed for GameCube, not the Wii. And so the reason it is so different from the earlier Paper Mario games is because they were like, oh, we already have a Paper Mario GameCube. So if we do make another one for GameCube, it has to really stand out and be a whole different thing. So like that gave the dev team, this is all like what I've heard from, like, I don't know, YouTube documentaries about gaming and stuff, but like they purposely made it super weird and different and had that creative freedom. My issue now is that these games have been stripped of like all of that intricacy that they used to have. And they weren't like super elaborate. Like, I'm just talking about, like, there was an XP system that was like really, really honed, in my opinion, like just really polished. And then the badge system. So like there was just so much opportunity for strategy. And it almost feels like it's easy to feel like they just don't trust you to figure it out anymore. Like they hand so much to you. And it's like there was like joy to figuring out elaborate like combat systems and stuff as a kid, or like dying a lot and learning through that. And that's why I like Dark Souls, and I love everything that FromSoft puts out, because that is still their philosophy. Like, yeah, this game is going to kick your butt and you're going to die a lot, but you're going to learn how to beat the game that way. So, and they know that their audience will step up to do it too. So like that works in their favor. Like they market the games as being brutal, and it works.
Yeah. I mean, Prepare to Die edition.
Yeah. Yo, yo.
Yeah.
Yo.
But you know, I, before you guys even said Dark Souls and we were talking about like the different boss mechanics and whatnot, I was actually thinking of something that I really liked about one of the bosses in Dark Souls. And I don't remember exactly what the boss was, but I remember it's one of the hardest bosses in the game. And the reason was because they changed the rhythm up. Like it was like in 4/4. Like if musically for all the bosses before this one, which was in 3/4, and it's like some dancing boss. I forgot what it was. Like, oh. I don't play Dark Souls because I'm really bad at video games, so I can't get past that.
There's literally a boss that like is a dancer in like Dark
Souls. In Dark Souls 3, Fariel the dancer, and she is fucking weird.
Yeah,
her rhythm is fucked up.
Thinking of her.
I was just thinking, like, that's that would be an interesting way to also switch up boss fights, too, is just, like, you have an established rhythm, and then you just change the rhythm a bit, and then that would add difficulty, but still, like, making it feel different enough to be like, okay, I need to, you know, master a new thing kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. What's that game? Like, that's like a dungeon crawler, but it's based on the music playing.
Crypt of the Necrodancer?
Yeah, and they made a Zelda one, too.
Yep.
Yeah.
I haven't played that, but it's
so fun. I love that game. Yeah, Cadence of Hyrule.
Yeah.
Yeah, I played a bit of it.
I feel like that's something you would really like. I have not. I've only seen, like, trailers, but, like...
That's actually, like a weird subgenre of games. There are a bunch that are, like, rhythm movement fighters.
Yeah.
It feels like.
I should play the original one because the Cadence of Hyrule, I love the soundtrack, but at the same time, like, the game feels a bit gimmicky to me.
Yeah, I can agree with that. I mean, it's just like taking Legend of Zelda and putting it to a beat. So it feels like that. Crypt of the Necrodancer is like the unique version where it's like you play the game through the dungeon.
Yeah. And they even reuse the character. So it's like, it almost makes... Because it almost feels like one of those crossovers that shouldn't have never been kind of like
a Dance Dance Revolution Mario Edition out there, so nothing's off the table.
I would be okay with that.
I'm okay with it. I wish they put it out again, like a re-release or something.
Well, here, like I wanted to steer the conversation to one more subject that I might end up doing this one day myself because of my career path, but I'm wondering, like, so Andrew right now, he's living in Japan. And so I'm just wondering, like, did your like development, what is the word I'm looking for? I'm thinking the word in Chinese, but your aspirations to become a game developer, did that like influence you moving to Japan?
I wouldn't say my aspiration to be a developer did that, because I was already in Japan when I really decided to try and do that. Like I Googled, literally I was sitting in a cafe and I just thought to myself, like, why have I not tried to make a game yet? Like that, it always felt like something I wanted to do, but like, why haven't I actually tried? Like, what's stopping me? And I was like, it seems so difficult, but like, unless I try, I'm not going to know. So I Googled, like, shamelessly, easiest coding software to learn, or like easiest coding language to learn. And like, there was all these tools for people specifically who wanted to make games, but a lot of them were like the drag and drop kind. And I was like, no. If I'm going to do this, I want to learn to actually write a code. And like the most accessible one seemed to be Game Maker Studio. So downloaded that, made a few horrible little things, like just little window games. But because of those horrible little creations, I was actually learning that, like, oh, I can do this. Like, and taking what I learned from each one. There was one I made of like this little cow in a tornado, and like all this furniture was like flying past him, and this is so gross, you had to literally shoot milk out of the udder as like jets to keep the cow in the air. And like the fact that got that mechanic to work, I was like, okay, like I'm gonna make a real game, but not based on this, because this is super weird and not gonna hit like something else. And then like I still have it. That would be actually funny to like put that somewhere, but
you put it as an April Fool's joke one day.
Yeah, like, guys, air jets out. This is not a cactus. What is this? Is that milk? What? But no, I was already in Japan. I think my love for games in general coincided with like developing an interest in Japan in general. There's a correlation. I wouldn't say it like made me come here, but like it all like plays into the same interest I have, I guess.
I mean, it sounds like you're a big Nintendo fanboy, so
that's
being in the country where they've made all that great stuff definitely feels...
Yeah, I've branched out more recently, but I like grew up with like basically all Nintendo. I had a PS2, though. I did.
I also had a PS2.
Yeah, good games. Yeah,
everyone had a PS2.
Yes, yeah. It's like illegal to be a gamer and not have had a PS2, honestly.
Because after like the DS and the Wii, it's like the best selling console of all time.
Yeah, they won that generation of consoles.
Yeah.
I still like the GameCube to this day, though.
The GameCube is a
I don't
a
know why people hate on the GameCube so much, because like even the GameCube is literally probably my favorite system, because it was just unique, and like there was a lot of good games for it, like some of my favorite games of all time.
Yeah,
but
it like kind of slipped under the radar for that like era, weirdly. And it's weird how like something like Melee is still like a cultural like staple from then.
Yeah,
but like that was the system itself didn't do great comparatively to like other.
I still remember to this day that Melee is one of the only games that have made me like rage quit so hard that I cried. Like, it was like Event 51.
Yes, I knew you were going to see Event Battles. I knew it.
Event 51, that one with Giga Bowser.
I didn't
like,
even
I remember.
I didn't even
like, I remember I figured out I can use Jigglypuff to just like spam them like over and over again with the sleep and like, yeah. And like, I remember like being like in fifth grade and like doing that for like the entire summer, and just one day just snapping and just throwing the controller across the room, almost breaking my TV, and just like huddling into the corner and just being like, why do I suck? Why am I here in this existence, you know? And just crying my eyes out for like an hour.
No,
and that's what I started thinking. It's like, maybe I should take games less seriously. You know,
I never made it to Giga Bowser. There was one event battle about Dr. Mario, and he had like a Nurse Peach, but it was just like her white dress alt. But for some reason, like the difficulty spike was like unreal, and she just kept like slapping me and like kicking me off the stage, and I couldn't do it anymore. Like, I think that that's probably the last event I made it to in Melee.
Man,
it's so funny how broken Melee is, but how it's like the pinnacle to so many people. It's like the standard.
That kind of goes back to our idea of the when developers just take a toy away from the players, basically. Because when they moved to Brawl, Sakurai was just like, I'm not putting anything that Melee had that makes it competitive in there.
Yeah.
It's like, it's not supposed to be competitive. So I'm going to take all of that away and make it just a party game.
Yeah.
Well, I think that kind of went along with the marketing strategy of the Wii, because it was Wii would like to play, and it was trying to get the family involved. And so then that's probably bleeding into Super Smash Bros. Brawl. And I remember as a kid feeling the gameplay of Brawl and being like, there's something missing here.
Yeah, I was like, this is weird. Like, because during Melee, I was so bad, but now I'm like kind of good. So like something's going on. Something's not right with Brawl. Like I'm doing kind of okay. So, and then I realized how much slower the game runs purposely, not like that it's like bad frame rate or anything, but like, purposely, it's like not as fast as Melee. I'm like, oh, that's why I'm better. Okay.
And then they add slipping.
Yeah. Oh, and my enemy slipped like 5 times. So that's why I'm doing so good.
Oh, hey, I had also another question about Japan is, so I know you, like, you haven't stated exactly why you moved to Japan, but I mean, we all know why. Like, so I'm just going to ask you, what's your favorite anime?
Funnily enough, I have actually never watched a full anime to the end, aside from one from like well over a decade ago called Higurashi, which is super gory. Don't watch it. Just don't watch it. It's like,
no, wait, I've watched like Berserker. It's fine.
Okay, but like, I don't know why middle school me was like so fascinated by this show. And like me and this one other kid in my school like watched it, and then we would like talk about it in school, and like, I had no place watching that in middle school. It was so messed up, the stuff that I saw. But anyway, probably that one, just out of like not having other options. I've watched anime, just not any like to the end, to like fairly like a set. So like that, besides that one. So like, it's good. Just don't watch it.
Higurashi? Is that what it is? Higurashi.
Higurashi, When They Cry.
I love that.
Yeah.
I watched when this. Don't watch it, though. I love the don't
condone. Like, you can, but like, and then it was weird because like, it's the most gory, like, horrible thing you could watch ever. But then they made like a chibi version of it, like a dating sim, and all the characters are like happy and like bubbly. And I'm like, y'all were like tearing each other apart like limb from limb, like now we're like dating, like what, how did you get from that? All right, I don't know, but yeah, don't watch it. Don't. I'm still trying to like block it from my memory.
That's really funny.
Yeah,
but like I just asked that question because the last, and this is for the audience to hear, like, because the last time we talked, like, he joked about how when he was in Japanese class, like, they were like, we all know why you're here. And then he was like, I've never really watched anime. And he's like, Pokemon? And everyone's like, oh, blasphemy. That's Pokemon's anime.
Yeah. No, they like judged me for saying Pokemon. I guess I could have said Higurashi, but like, no one ever knows that when I say it.
Oh, say, that, like, sounds really, I'm pretty sure, under the radar.
All the attackers.
I don't know if it's under the, because like, only here, only one person that I ever mentioned it to like knew it. I don't know. There was another one that I also don't recommend, but I didn't watch it to the end. Chobits.
Oh, I back in middle school, I think my friend's sister used to watch Chobits.
Yeah,
and I was like, this is really weird.
Yeah, and like a lot of anime is weird, but like Chobits is really weird. Like,
that's when I first exposure to like ecchi animes that like give you the glimpse of like nude figures, but they're like, but we don't actually show it. It's just implied.
I just most remember, of the way. Like, I don't know why fifth grade, sixth grade me had access to this shit. Like,
because YouTube was the Wild West. You could just look up an anime and they'd have all of the parts that somebody had ripped from a Japanese, like, VCR.
And you would, like, kind of give your computer a virus trying to, like, watch the next episode. Yeah.
LimeWire.
And it was, like, super blurry. And then you would get the version without subtitles and you're like, so now I have to download another and get another virus.
Yeah.
Or you just be like, oh, now I gotta learn Japanese.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, like, Cody, did you have, I have another question, but like, I feel like I've been stealing questions away from Cody. You got any questions?
I think you can ask the last one and then we can wrap up.
Okay. Well, this is a question that I think I want to wrap up maybe with all our guess in the future, like,
ooh, okay,
and we talked about this before on one episode, but have you ever had a near-death experience?
Oh my god, I don't know how near death it was, but it felt near death. There was a flight I took back from Los Angeles to Miami when I was in college after spring break. And, like, turbulence is fine. Like, I'm not afraid of turbulence. But, like, when I tell you, like, looking in the plane's, like, aisle, like, where the flight attendant pushes the cart, it literally was tipped, like, downward. Like, you could see, it looked like you were on the top of a hill. And, like, I heard people, like, praying and, like, everybody was, like, crying. And, like, for 10 seconds, it felt like a roller coaster ride, like, where you go down. And even the flight attendant on the speaker, like, his voice was, like, shaking. Like, he sounded horrified. He's like, everybody, sit down, sit down. And we were like, oh, my God, holy shit. We got no explanation for the whole five-hour flight. And when we finally landed, they're like, oh, yeah, like, over Colorado, there was, like, a cyclone bomb, which is apparently just a blizzard that, like, whips up out of nowhere. Like, yeah, all the other pilots in the area were having issues. And I'm like, and none of y'all communicated, like, to not go through the flight. Like, you didn't tell each other about it. So, like, my perspective on life kind of, like, changed that day. So I don't know how close to death I was. I was probably fine the whole time, but it did not feel that way in the moment. So,
yeah, death was probably kind of like, you know, how, like, sometimes, like, when you're dating and you see a girl that you might want to talk to and you're like, I should go talk to her. It's like, no. It's like, I should go talk to her. No, I have other stuff to do. That's probably what death was feeling that day with you.
Yeah. And it spared me, thank God. So,
well, yeah. I'm glad your plane didn't crash in Colorado and you had a Donner Party situation go on.
Yeah. Yeah, it that definitely messed me up. Not gonna lie. So, like, when I had to fly to Japan, I was like, how am I gonna do this? And, like, I'm old enough to drink now, so.
So now
just
you
order
a
bunch of whiskey on the rocks.
Yeah, just, yeah. I don't want to be conscious for the 13 hours it takes to get to and from Japan anymore. So.
Oh.
Yeah.
I've heard people just, like, take an Ambien or two and just, like, pass out.
Yeah. There's a lot of methods to.
Well, now I, like, strategically will stay up super late the day before, which you're not supposed to do when you have a flight, but just to purposely, like, crash on the flight. So,
I've heard that too.
Yeah.
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 Cool, cool.
So,
well, this has been awesome.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Like, I just want to talk about games with you guys, like, outside of podcasts, to be honest.
Of course. Like, that, you know, it's funny because, like, It feels so weird for me and Cody to, like, just talk on the computer just regular sometimes now, because it feels like we're always, like, in podcast mode now.
Yeah,
it's like
should we be, like, recording together?
Sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes, but, you know, like, we live close to each other, so now that, like, I'm not in China, so, like, it's, you know. But at the same time, it's like we're not used to it because of the pandemic anymore.
Yeah.
So it feels a little weird. It feels like everyone is trying to transition out of, like, cave mode.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know? Like, stepping out of the sunlight and being like, oh,
so Japan's,
no.
We're getting in cave mode here. It's, like, weirdly going up here. So, like.
Really?
Yeah. So
see, I haven't heard anything about vaccines and stuff over in Japan yet.
I know it started, but it's like starting with like the elderly, like everywhere else. And then a friend today actually told me that we won't, like younger people won't get the vaccine until like September, which I'm just like,
that sounds.
I live 2 hours away from the first ever official Nintendo theme park and I can't go. And it sucks. And I'm so angry about it. Uh-huh. And like, I don't know. It's just like,
oh man.
Yeah. It's the most frustrating thing ever.
I didn't know there was a Nintendo theme park. I knew they were opening up a Studio Ghibli.
Theme park. Well, it's not, I shouldn't say Nintendo theme park. It's a Universal theme park that now has a Nintendo like branch.
Mm-hmm.
And only that's the Mario part opened, but there's like a rumored Donkey Kong part that's going to open, and like the American one is apparently going to have more than just Mario, but that might be a rumor. So like, I want like Metroid laser tag, like,
oh, that'd be just awesome.
Like, you can make something out of every series, like a Zelda escape room, but it's like a dungeon. Like, give me like as if I was in the game. You know what I mean?
Pixelize me.
Yes,
put me in the game.
Put me in the game. So
the more you people talk about Japan and all these amazing things, like in my head, Japan is just like a fairyland, almost like a fairy tale land. Like, and I know it's not just like that because there's a lot of like Saturday men that just like every day, like completely like just destroy their consciousness with like just hard work.
Yeah.
But like at the same time, like, hearing this kind of stuff makes me just want to learn Japanese way, way more than
any other language. Yeah, no, talk to me anytime. I think you learn languages better by studying with people, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, like, I'm in, like, my silent phase with Japanese right now, and Japanese is such, like, a different language logically that I need to really be immersed in it for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. But I'm starting to understand a lot of different concepts, kind of like, I like the idea in Japanese where, like, it's very much like a computer language sometimes, like where you're like saying like what different grammatical parts of the sentence yeah. are with like the particles and whatnot,
mm-hmm.
like, or even like saying something like koto and then, you know, whatever you want to comment on that situation.
Mm-hmm.
And I even start realizing I understand little bits and pieces out of like these anime clips on YouTube. Like, mm-hmm. I understood one, what is it? Just this girl said something, something, and then toimashita.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, wait, I understood that. It's like, I said whatever, you know? Mm-hmm. So like, yeah, I've been thinking about it. Like, there's certain like grammatical things I kind of want to pick your brain about. But yeah, like right now,
I'll tell you right now that still happens. Like that excitement, like I understood, like it still happens.
Oh yeah, it still happens with me. And well, maybe not Chinese, like Mandarin as much, but like with like the dialects.
Mm-hmm.
Like I was speaking to my, because we went to go see my one of my old Chinese teachers like 2 days ago, and first of all, it was amazing to me, like, because I remember when I was first talking to her, like all those years back, whenever she had office hours, I'd go in and I'd just like, it was not really speaking with her in Chinese, it was more at her in Chinese
yeah.
at that point. But now it's like that we can joke and make like really like puns and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like it makes it's like, but not just that I was able to have a conversation with her in her native language, which is Taiwanese. You know, to actually like
yeah.
speak and understand what she's saying, and like, and then also she was really interested in that, in me and my wife speaking in my wife's local language too, and just being able to like sit there and show her, like, yeah, you taught me in the beginning, and look, because of you, I'm able to get here.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
I thought that was really cool. And also she was like, don't call me teacher. That makes me feel old. You know?
Yeah. No, it was cool. There's some guys in my apartment complex from Myanmar, and like, we both speak Japanese as like a second language. So like when we talk in Japanese, it's like, this is weird. Like, cause like we're both communicating in a language we're learning and we both don't speak the same native language. So it's like this like bridge between cultures. Like, I don't know. I think that's really cool.
It happens in Chinese with me too. Like, especially with Russians. Like a lot of Russians, English are not as good as their Chinese in China.
Oh, really?
So I have a lot of Russian. Yeah, I have a lot of Russian. I remember one girl in particular that the first time I talked to her, like we were living in this place like Yoga Village, I think I told you before. And it was like this hostel where all these international people came. And like one day, like one of my Russian Ukrainian friends brought this other girl in, and like we were usually they just talk to each other in Russian, you know. And so like they brought me over and we were just talking, and it was interesting how silent she was being when we were speaking English. She wasn't saying anything. I was like, that's kind of weird. And then like then she mentioned that, oh, she's been here and like she's not very good at English. She speaks Russian and Chinese all day. And so I switched into Chinese. She instantly lit up. Like she went from like super, super like what is it? What's the word in English? Introverted to being like super extroverted. Like all of a sudden she had things to say.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's interesting, like that as much as people say like English is the international language now, it hasn't really rooted itself as the true international language. Like if anything, I would say the international language is maybe broken English, but it's not English because like, mm-hmm. yeah, like there's still situations where you have to speak to other people in other mutually skilled languages, you know?
I think that notion of English is like being the most global language is that it spans the most number of countries as the first mm-hmm. language, not necessarily that it has like the most speakers, because it doesn't. It's like third, fourth, maybe.
Well, like in the with world. Second L2 second? Speakers, it does have the most.
I actually thought it was like even under Spanish now. But
well, it, native speakers, it's like number three.
Oh, okay,
like.
Okay.
Mandarin is number one with native speakers, but even that's kind of debatable for mm-hmm. me. And then Spanish is second, and then third is English. But first, like on top of the list for L2 speakers, which is second language speakers, it's English.
Okay.
And then it would be, I think, Spanish and then Mandarin. I don't know. I think Mandarin's actually way down the list because it's higher on the native speaker mm-hmm. list. And then it might be like something like French or Russian or Hindi, actually.
But well, yeah. I hate to kill this awesome conversation. Yeah. We're definitely hitting the 1.5 hour mark. So, Andrew, where can people find you on the internet to get updates on Era Jared?
Yeah, I am on Instagram as at EastKoastGames, coast with a K, no spaces. And I'm on Twitter. This is really sad. I don't know my Twitter at. This just shows that I don't like social media, but I still want you to follow me. Yeah, it's mm-hmm. at East Coast Games on Twitter as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely use Insta more. So mm-hmm. Twitter is more just like what I'm thinking or like a pretty sunset I see. Uh-huh. Like, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Life stuff.
Well, there will be links in the description, of course.
Yeah.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Andrew, thanks for being on.
Thank you guys.
Super awesome. We'll have to have you on again sometime, like talk about languages with Laz while I listen.
Yeah, he gets to teach me about Mandarin.
Yeah, totally, totally. And I actually feel like we have like achieved across the other pond this time because Andrew is in Japan.
Literally.
Yep.
Literally.
Yep, yeah, we made it. We've gone full circle back from when Laz is in China.
Quite literally.
Now we can really jump back in the pond and swim back over.
Yeah. So all right.
We'll see you guys.
Yeah. Thanks for listening.
Thank you.
Yep.